Hello, my name is Yelena Burtseva. I'm an author and the CEO of Know Hours, the Russian genealogy project where I teach people how to find their ancestors and create systems from some tools and partnership for this purpose. Name of my project, Know Hours. On Russian, it is Znai Naших. It's idiom. It's like you tell me, take a look at our sort, take a look at our family. I see some points which you should know about Russian genealogy if you want to find your ancestry in Russia. And actually, a lot of these topics are related to former USSR countries too. So when I talk about Russia in my speech, you should mainly think about all the former Russian territories, the Russian Empire and the USSR. And I'm starting with the features and complexities. The first issue which every genealogist should understand is the preservation of documents. And we see different situations for each region, archive, and period. Main reasons are historical situation. It's about wars. For example, World War I, World War II, revolution, civil war in the 20th century in the Russian territories. Of course, it's fires, floods, and we can talk about fires and floods not being predictable, and they could occur in any region, any time, and involving any archive. Our history, especially in the 20th century, I mean wars and other military conflicts, destroyed a lot of our documents and archive funds. These were destroyed or stolen by enemies on our territory. Sometimes these were destroyed by our own citizens because they understood that if enemies were to take these documents, it could have been dangerous for our people and our country. So if they couldn't take these documents to a safe place, they usually burned them. So you should understand that some documents could be lost, but I say that we always have some ways for search. Next very important point is changing of administrative territorial divisions. Russian state power and government were built on these divisions. And of course, genealogy documents were created, saved, and archived based on administrative territorial divisions. We have some major periods: the Russian Empire, USSR, and Russian Federation now. Each period has a common territorial structure. But unfortunately for researchers, sometimes some territories could change their bonds to territorial entities a few times per year and even per month. How could this influence us? Documents were mainly sent to specific archives based on territorial principle. And if city A was in region A in some years, and then this city A's territorial division was changed and it was referred to as region B for another years, we should search for information in at least the archives of regions A and B. Also, we should remember that till the revolution in 1917, the Orthodox Church served as the state system for demographic accounting in the Russian Empire. So we should know also the church divisions, parishes, prichody, to find documents about our ancestors there. Church divisions changed their territory and settlements from time to time. Mainly, they didn't coincide with the state division of the territory. Next main thing is the archival system in Russia. It's a very huge topic, so I'm saying only a few words there. We have different types of archives. Main types which we should know, it's federal archives, regional, municipal, local, and departmental. Based on the type of archive, It collects and stores different documents from territories and organizes different access for researchers. Usually you need documents from some archives to find your ancestry history. You can't make this using only one archive. Access to archive could be online for free or paid when you can see documents online on special site. Answers your official requests when archive employees receive your official request and prepare answer, make copies for you and send this information. Offline research in archive. When you visit archive and work with documents in this archive offline. Each archive has own set of options of access. You should define which archives you need and research information on sites about access and services in these archives. If we don't know which archive should store the documents we need, we would request information, I guess, from their own archive. Of course, we would receive an answer like, sorry, we don't have this information for you. And we could think that we have hit a wall. We can't get the information, but the documents are in different archive. Actually, I guess it's one of the top brick walls for researchers in Russia, based on my experience. So you should understand which archive collects documents you need. Sometimes it's related to the mess in the archives. Of course, it depends on the region, situation, archive. I don't want to say that it's usual situation in all archives in Russia. But sometimes documents are found in another archive years later. They shouldn't be there, but they are. Maybe it was a mess after the war or another historical situation. Also, we have such a large quantity of archival documents, we can't say we know 100%. And our archivists work on the descriptions, compilation of directories, collections, and sometimes we see news that in place in some archive have found new documents related to some topics. Of course, for good research, you should know the basic Russian history and documents and collections, funds, fonde, which can contain information regarding your ancestors. We have common documents which were created for every person in each state. For example, metrics about birth, marriage, and deaths. Also, we have a lot of funds, collections with documents related to a specific estate. For example, special records for noblemen. Usually you can find information even for poor peasant, but you should know where it's collected. And all these resources could be divided into main, additional, and indirect type of documents. Often researchers concentrate on main sources and collections, funds. It's not good for two reasons. They lost a lot of quality information about the real lives of their ancestors from additional and indirect sources. And if main sources were destroyed, as we said, by wars, fires, floods, and so on, they guess it's an obstacle and they have hit a wall. But I have seen a lot of examples where additional sources could give answers for the next step in our genealogy search. So we say that till 1917 we had church documents as demographic control. And after the revolution in 1917 we had a state system for population registration. So it was called ZAGS, Civil Registry Offices. And this structure is still there. They have their own special laws, rules, and forms. And before December 2020, we had to know from which territory's office your ancestry to collect the documents. But from January 2021, all offices should have a common online ZAGS database. And you can request information from any office. They should see the data on this database and print the information for you. Of course, you should know names and dates. Actually, it's usual rule for Russia genealogy search. I guess it's for any country genealogy search. We have three main points we should know. Who, names, when, dates, or at least period, and where, geography. But actually, there are a lot of issues regarding this Common Zax database. It could be errors in this database. Also, database contains only main information. It means that before you can receive additional information, which employees of registry office, Zax, can find in real paper documents about your ancestry. Now you will just receive only a little of the main data, without details, even if these details were in the paper document. Also, the next point is very important to Zax, but not only for them. It influences some documents from the archives, especially the departmental archives, for example, FSB archive. I'm talking about the access to documents based on the laws about personal data. Law says that if there is personal or family secret information in document, for example, names, dates, and so on, this document in archive or organization where it's stored could see only person who is owner of this information or his or her successor, or person with power of attorney from owner for 75 years from document creation date. After 75 years, all people can see these documents. So, for some documents till 75 years old, you should have all documents confirming kinship between you and your ancestry. I call it the kinship chain. Please see example on the slide. It's power of attorney from owner. Or you could wait to access the document till end of special period in 75 years. But some documents are kept for a limited period and then they are destroyed. Example, medical records, pension documents, and so on. So you haven't got access now if you haven't got some documents kinship chain and it isn't 75 years old document. But in few years, these documents of your ancestry will be destroyed based on the laws and archival rules. And in this situation, maybe you won't see unique information. For example, letters from World War II from grandfather and his photo in his pension documents. Next problem is that we haven't got a common database. Of course, we have a lot of sites, databases, but they aren't complete. And a lot of archives don't have online access to their main documents. In recent years, the situation is changing and archives are digitized more intensive. But the online access to the necessary genealogy information is still very far away in many archives. Usually, genealogy requests are paid services in Russian archives. The price is calculated by each archive for each request. Usually, it includes the working time of employee and the cost per page copies. Sometimes the same type of document can vary in price many times. Of course, there is information and there are categories of citizens who have free access, for example, if it's related repression documents. Some archives absolutely don't take genealogy search requests from people. And they will answer to you, please visit our archive and search yourself, please. And the last main issue for today is the knowledge of English of employees in the archives and in other organizations where you can send your requests. Often the English level of employees is not adequate to have difficult discussions. It's good if they can read and answer to your mail, maybe, and it could be an issue for foreign researchers. Are you already worried and have changed your mind about looking for your Russian roots? Don't worry. Let's talk about the possibilities for searching. There are some databases where you can find online information from your armchair. Please see some sites on the slide. It's related to World War I, World War II, repressions, and a lot of copies of documents about birth, marriages, death could be found on Family Search. Of course, based on your search situation, there are another additional resources, but you can't find all information in internet on sites. You should use Archive and Zax. Please keep in mind all my earlier topics for good research. If you make homework, I mean find names, dates, understand the administrative territorial division, understand specific resources, and so on, you could find some very important information in the internet. Some archives have their online collection on their site. If documents about your ancestry are in those archives, you can find and read the documents online. Some of them are placed on Family Search too. Of course, if you don't know Russian, you could have an issue with reading the old Russian handwritten text in the scan copies. But if we talk about the scan documents from archives, it's usually the main sources. For example, main source is metric book. And it's possible to understand the structure of the text in metric books because births, marriages, deaths were written in the same columns in special forms. So you can try to understand logic and find records yourself. You can try to send a request to archive and organizations in English via mail, site or email, or in Russian. Please see this page of my project where I collect some help for you. If you can't send a request or you don't understand Russian text, you have additional opportunities. You can involve local, regional, individual assistant in the archive who will search and scan documents about your ancestry. Of course, it's very important to find a good assistant on this way. Also, you can request complete end-to-end genealogy research from the archive. But not every archive does such kind of research for people. Also, you can order complete end-to-end research for Russian roots from Russian genealogy company or Russian individual genealogist. Usually, an individual genealogist will be cheaper than a company. When you will try to find individual genealogist or company, you should read feedbacks, understand their research experience and research specialization. It could be, for example, military research or common genealogy research or Jewish genealogy and so on. Good option if you can find and make contact with your relatives from Russia and coordinate their research with them, especially if they fall in love with genealogy too. And of course, I'm inviting you to join my project. There is a course on how to find your ancestry in Russia if you know Russian language. If you don't know Russian, I can help you with your research in individual coaching. Also, on our site, you can delegate your research to our partners, very professional genealogists. Please keep in mind that you can find a lot of information in Russia. Of course, there is some local search specific, but you have some ways to find all information you need. Have a luck in your research, and you will say at the end, take a look at our sort. Take a look at our family. Знай наших. Thank you.